Today we're going to be installing an electric power steering kit onto my friend's S13 hatchback. So we have a few items here that we're going to be utilizing, and I'll go over each step of the process. First, and most importantly, you need your pump. This pump comes out of a Volvo, and there are a few variations of it. This one in particular is the one with the cap on the housing. Some of them are like relocated, and it's very important that you order it with the plugs, unless you can find the plugs separately. The fittings over here don't really matter because we're going to be changing them. Then I have some square tubing that we're going to use to make a mount for this pump. Next, we have our fittings to the rack. This is going to be the chassis specific piece. Basically, this kit can probably work for any car as long as it has a hydraulic power steering rack, but these fittings are designed to specifically fit an S13. And then we have our pressure line. This is actually a nitrous line. It's 10 feet of -6 AN stainless steel. Moving down, we have 10 feet of low pressure AN hose. This is -6 as well. Then we have various fittings down here that we're going to be utilizing to match up these hoses to the rack and also the pump. These are -6 AN hose holders just to clean things up. And then if we have time for it, this is a electric power steering controller. To start us off, let's jack the car up and take a look at the rack and pinion, see if we can get those fittings on, and then we can decide where we want to route our pressure and return hose under the car. I have made a video about doing this job on my S13 in the past, but mine's for right-hand drive, so I figured I'd make another one for a left-hand drive. Plus, it's been like 2 or 3 years since that video came out, so hopefully this one's a little smoother for you guys. Additionally, I will be leaving all the part numbers in the description, and if you do plan to use this kit, please consider dropping a like on the video, as this was a lot of research to figure out the first time. Now, Chris's S13 is similar to mine in the way that it does not have a four-cylinder, it has an RB six-cylinder. Unfortunately, his RB did not come with a power steering pump. Instead of trying to source an RB20 power steering pump, we figured it'd be easier just to throw on this electric kit. And with this being a left-hand drive, that means the fittings are going to be on the left side. Got the car up in the air, and it just started raining. I'm gonna see if I can keep working through the rain. As long as it's not downpouring, we should be good. If we go under the car, look here at the rack and pinion. These are the two pressure lines that go from basically the rack to the rack. And then these are the two that go to and from the pump. You can see there's still a line on there. We're gonna have to take that off. But I wanted to visually inspect how these other two lines look, because without them, you have no power steering. And check it out, we got some damage going on. So we're gonna have to order this line too. But in the meantime, we can still set up the rest of the kit. Now I'm starting to think about where I'm gonna route this, because I was initially planning on routing it on this side of the car, but that is super close to the exhaust. As you can see, the brake lines are actually tucked on the other side of the frame rail. That's where I have my power steering lines go. But it worked out because my rack fittings are on that side. So I don't know if I wanna try and bridge this over to that side, or if I wanna run it on the outside of the frame rail, but then I'd have to cross over. I don't know, we'll figure it out. We'll see how much line we have available to use. All right, this was the return side. So that means the bigger fitting is for the return, the smaller one is for the pressure. Don't get those confused when you're hooking up your lines. That'll cause big issues. Now, technically these rack fittings should seal through this little O-ring, but just for an added level of protection and sealant, I'm going to add some of this PTFE tape. We'll figure out what size these are before we thread them into the car. 19. Doesn't hurt to clean up our mounting surface a little bit. Clean things up. Since these fittings are steel and it's going into an aluminum rack, you really want to be careful that you're not over tightening these, because you'd be surprised how easily aluminum threads will strip out. Like, yeah, tighten them, but don't like crank it down. You know what I mean? Rack fittings, done. Probably the easiest step of this entire job. So I just ordered the same exact fittings I used for my S13. So we have a 90 here and a 45. And on mine, I used a 90 degree coming out of the pressure side. So we might try that one first. That way we can try and point this fitting towards the rear. But you have to remember, we have to go around the return side, because if you go around on top of it, obviously it's gonna block the line. Since this is an AN fitting to an AN port, this definitely does not need that thread sealant. First fitting is installed. Now let's grab our line and just put that first end on. I'm not gonna tighten it down all the way, but we need to stretch this thing all the way to the back and see how much room and slack we have. Do we wanna run it on this side? Or do we have enough slack to cross over where the subframe is? Wow, it gets pretty far actually. Definitely plenty if we go on that side. Let's see if we can cross the subframe, because I would ideally like to utilize avoiding the exhaust, as well as we can share the mounts with the brake lines. That'll save us a lot of time on this install. Since we're gonna be crossing the subframe, I'm gonna take off this fitting first, because I'm gonna add that additional 45 and bend it towards that side of the car. This 45 bend was actually for getting onto the pump, but if I have to, I'll just order another one. All right, this fitting is finger tight. Let's see how it looks if we throw it that way.
So this is what I'm thinking for the route. Somehow mount it to that side of the subframe, tie it in down here to the fuel lines and brake lines. Just been trying to line it up. All right, honestly, that should be ample, because I want to go up into the chassis around this area.
Jumping spider for posterity. I don't know if it's actually a jumping spider, but it's moving all glitchy. Are those green eyes?
Since we do want to run the line on the opposite side of the car, let's go ahead and make our AN fitting for our return side. That way we can attach it to the rack and begin mounting our lines and bringing everything towards the rear.
These are always fun to make. First, we'll thread this piece out and you put the cap onto the hose. You want to push this cap down far enough to the point where you can see the hose bottom out on the threads on the inside. Then we'll thread the rest of the fitting into this port here.
The fitting is fully tightened down. I personally like to hold it down and try and tug it to make sure that it's not going to come out on us. I've had that happen before. It's not a good time. This one's good to go. So let's install it on the car. Honestly, I might have to order another 45 or 90 off of this rack fitting for the return side. But just for now, we're gonna get a rough mock-up of the lines and we can install that later. Luckily, they're pretty easy to do. Yeah, you can see we definitely need another bend here. I don't wanna flex this hose that much, you know what I mean? It's honestly not too much, but I don't know, I'd feel more comfortable with another fitting here. I ended up installing a few of these line mounts. So I lined them up to where the brake line mounts are on the chassis. That way I'll have something solid to mount to. Now that we've made our way to the rear, I want to then go in the trunk area and see where I can drill the hole in the floorboard to fit these lines up.
Got the interior taken apart so we can get better access to where we want to drill. Now ideally I'd like the opening to be somewhere around here. You can kind of see this line and this is where the trim covers. I kind of like it to be tucked because then you can just have little exit holes on the side of it and it'll look really clean. But instead of just drilling straight down and not knowing what I'm drilling into, I'm going to drill a tiny hole from the bottom going up. And then I can use one of these to open up that hole nicely, or a hole dozer.
I'm going to aim to drill the hole right where the floor pan levels out, right next to the brake lines. All right, I got the tiny hole drilled. Let's see how we did.
Now we definitely don't want to leave this metal raw because eventually it will rust. So I'm going to apply a little bit of paint there. Then I'm going to wrap that hole with some rubber lining because I don't want the hoses to rub against it and then burst. This fuel hose should be plenty thick. Trimmed a little piece of that hose off, cut the backside out, so now we can wrap it around this hole.
Now we just got to fish these lines through our new hole.
Now that we've got the lines up here, we can start deciding where we want our power steering pump. Now on mine, I have it right behind the shock tower, so right about this area. But since we had to cross over the subframe, we lost a lot of our distance on our lines. So I might have to relocate this one to either about here or just to make it look a little more aesthetically pleasing, I'll try and level it up with the shock tower. That way it doesn't take up too much trunk space being in an awkward spot, you know?
So next I want to take off these fittings and start prepping this thing.
That way we can test fit all the lines and fittings just to verify it's going to fit correctly. Then we can start thinking about the bracket we want to make for this to fit directly where we want it to. Because, you know, depending on where you put it, the bracket could look different. This is the pressure fitting that we just took off the pump.
This is how it compares to the fitting that we're going to be utilizing. The distance may not be exact, but it does work.
The rubber bushing does bottom out internally before this edge, which is what's most important. Part number for that. But again, all the part numbers are going to be in the description. Because this is an internal seal, we don't need to use that thread sealant. So at this point, this is where we want our power steering pump to sit, closest to the lines here and closest to the seat. So I'm going to start making a mount for this pump. I'll be utilizing a few pieces here. First and foremost, some square tubing. Pretty sure this is half inch, nothing too crazy. Then I have some various nuts and bolts, plus some rubber grommets for the pump to sit on, because you don't want to hard mount this to metal. That'll vibrate and make a nasty noise. Cut these three into even length. We got some hardware I'm going to attach to it. That way we can mount the pump to it. These three that I cut are going to be mounted upright like this. And then I'm going to weld the nut right on top. That way I can thread the bolt on and hold it. It'll all make sense in a second here. So I've attached all three of those pieces to the pump. Now I'm going to chop down some more of this metal and basically brace it in. With them being three all by themselves, I don't really think that's too structural. So probably weld one on this side and one on the other side. Obviously, we can't bridge this one because the pump is in the way, but two should be fine. I went ahead and put some tape on the bottom because I do plan on painting this so it doesn't rust away. And I'm going to need to weld this at the chassis, so I don't want to paint that area just yet. So next, I want to mount the pump to this bracket yet again and then test fit it in the car so I can mark on the chassis where we want to weld this on, because I'm pretty sure there's sound deadening in the way, so I'm going to have to grind some of that out. While that paint is drying for that bracket, we can start getting the sound deadening off. And I know, you guys have told me, dry ice does work best for getting this out. But I don't have any here, so I'm just gonna do the old-fashioned way. Just peel it up. Got the bracket fully welded onto the car. Very sturdy, not wobbly at all. Put a little paint booth protection here. We're gonna coat these welds and honestly try and coat this area so it cleans it up a little bit. Once we do that, start figuring out the wiring situation. All right, that's looking pretty good. Gonna let that dry for a minute. We got Chris over here installing his livery on this side of the car now. And we also went to the store and got some wire. So first things first. Power and ground, pretty obvious. One goes to the battery, one goes directly to ground. We have some wire here. This is 6 gauge. Pretty sure this is 8 gauge, but it's always a good idea to run a size bigger, especially if you plan on extending it longer than factory specifications. I don't actually know what the factory spec is. His battery's in the front of the car, so front to back, yeah, we're definitely going to up the gauge there. Secondly, we also picked up another line for his power steering. Remember this one that got smushed? So I'm gonna try and chop off these fittings and fit them onto this copper line because these fittings are incorrect. So we'll get to that eventually. We got our sub harness made. All I really did was extend these two wires to have a ring terminal on each end. That one goes all the way up to the battery, and this one's just gonna go to the ground, probably in the trunk. I did wrap some of this sheathing around just to make it look nice to where it inserts into the interior. But now we need to figure out how we're gonna wire our signal. Now you can see that there's 3 wires coming out. The one that's separate is actually gray with a blue stripe. This will be our signal wire if we're not gonna use a controller. I am gonna extend these other two just so we can maybe try that out in the future. And if you just wire the blue striped wire to power, then it'll run on defaults. I don't know exactly how much pressure it puts out, but it's not 100%. I know I'm jumping ahead here a little bit, and that's because I don't want to take up too much time on just the wiring. I've already installed the wiring into the car, and I know you guys know how wiring works. Power to power, ground to ground. In this case, I put a 60 amp inline fuse inline to the pump. Now I'm working on replacing, actually making that line that broke on the rack. So I chopped the fittings off of the old line here, chopped the new line in half because it was too long, slid on our fittings that we need, and now I'm in the process of making the flare. And this flare needs to be inverted, just like that. Never seen bunnies just play like that. But we did get this flare all dialed in. That's one side, and that's the other side. Sweet. Now let's throw it on the car. New line going on. One turn at a time. At this point, the lines under the car are ready to go. The wiring is ready to go. All we gotta do now is install the pump and turn it on. Well, we gotta put fluid in it too. So I'm gonna put the washers down first, then grab our rubber bushings. That way these absorb all the vibrations. Pump is nice and secure. Next, let's work on putting our lines on. Probably put on the pressure line first since that is on the bottom. And then we'll attach our return, but we're gonna need a clamp for that one. This is actually a fancy clamp, as I call it, because it looks like it's an AN fitting, but really it's just a clamp. Lines are fully installed, and you can see how fancy that looks. Now let's plug in our wiring. As of right now, only our signal wire is connected. I did not connect the CAN bus wires. Hopefully we'll have time for that. Power and ground.
And our ground is right here. The power goes all the way to the battery terminal. 60 amp fuse in line. That'll look real nice tucked into the trim there. All that's left is filling her up, turn it on.
Absolutely.
You ready for this?
Yeah, let's do it.
You've never had power steering in this car,
never,
right?
Never, never.
How long years. Have you had it? 10 years?
Yeah, 10 years, no power steering.
Okay, well, today's the day you're gonna get power steering.
There you go.
All right. So this pump does not take the same fluid as an S chassis. S chassis take Dextron 3, so I'm gonna match the S chassis power steering rating because we would rather replace this pump if something goes wrong than the rack, because these racks are getting harder to find. Plus, honestly, this pump can take Dextron 3. May not be designed for it, but it does work with it. And I will say I did drain the fluid out that was in here. Now this is full to the brim, but again, it has to fill up both lines, pressure and return, plus the rack, which I'm sure is completely empty considering it didn't have fluid in it for 10 years. I am gonna put the cap on because I don't want it shooting out. So we have a 10 amp fuse to the signal wire. It doesn't need a relay because the pump is the relay. Ignition on, there should be a few second delay, and it turns on. So far, no leaks over here. Let's check under the car. Nothing's coming out. How's it looking up there?
No leaks so far.
All right, let's bleed it. So all we're gonna do is just turn the wheel all the way left and all the way right. I think it's a nice wheel. Style.
Sure.
Okay. All right, let's check the fluid. Now we've done some turning here. Oh, it didn't even drop that much. We might need to put this on the ground and actually put some load on it. But so far, so good. That's pretty satisfying. Dude, first time steering it.
Oh. It's not steering. That's crazy.
It works. It works. You don't need two hands on the wheel to turn it.
Crazy.
10 years later.
Yeah, it feels like a car now. It's crazy.
Slight rub. Sounds so good. Sounds real good.
I'm all in.
So what do you think? Worth it?
Dude, awesome. Totally worth it.
You'd recommend it?
Yeah. Yeah, 10 out of 10 would recommend.
Hell yeah. And we have his setup that he just turns on the key and the pump turns on.
Right on.
Boom, pump's off, car's off.
Love that.
Perfect.
Love it. It works.
Man, this thing looks sweet too. Mm-hmm. We gotta throw your front bumper on.
Yeah, we gotta finish the aero. I mean,
the livery?
Yeah, livery in general.
So close.
So close.
The power steering looks so cool peeking through the trunk, but it doesn't look too cool seeing the shock tower. So I'm gonna try and trim this piece right now so we can fit it so it looks clean. After some tidying up, this is what we're looking like. Looks pretty swell, eh?
Looks pretty good.
I think we're about, what do you think, about $400 into this whole kit?
Yeah, probably. About $400.
That's not too bad.
Mostly in wires.
Yeah, so we actually forgot to get 6-gauge wire ahead of time, so we had to go to the store and get some, and man, they taxed us.
Taxed hard.
How much did you pay for?
$100.
$100 in 6-gauge wire. Yeah, it was like $6 a foot. Definitely order that online ahead of time. But overall, this kit is pretty useful. Can be put in basically any car you want. The line pressure isn't bad for running it on default. You could also shorten your pressure line by putting your pump farther up, closer to the rack, like maybe in the engine bay. You get a better pressure to your rack if that does bother you. But with an RB in this car, the rack still can keep up with it just fine. So yeah, overall, great install. Hope you guys enjoyed this one. Let me know if you have any questions down below. I'll try and answer any of those that you may have. Don't forget to drop a like if you haven't already. Subscribe to see more. I'll see you guys in the next one. Peace. Crazy.